I will talk today about political opposition in Russia and the rebirth of political opposition is somewhat relatively new phenomena which has been observed upon the wave of mass political protests in 2011-2012 which swept Moscow, St. Petersburg and other Russian cities, and the re-emergence of the opposition contributed to yet another phenomenon known as a negative consensus. In other words, various groups, various politicians, regardless to their ideational stances, are more or less united in rejection of the current political regime and in understanding of needs of its rehaul in one way or another, even though they are quite diverse in terms of desirable future. And of course, this is the major step forward if we compare the current developments with what has been observed in Russia in mid-2000s when the opposition was weak, divided and not played an important role in domestic politics. So there is a step forward, but whether or not it's the only step forward, and what are the major challenges and what are strategic choices for the Russian opposition in coming years. Let me start from the brief vocabulary of what we mean by the opposition. I use the broadest possible definition, and I include to the opposition either organized groups or individual actors, those who are open rivals to the ruling group of Russia's regime, regardless to ideational stances and organizational forms. This could be individual politicians, this could be certain political parties or organized groups or some sort of communities, but still this is the minimal common denominator. And of course we have to make a major distinction between two segments of the opposition, one of which called systemic opposition, which are somewhat officially licensed and controlled by the ruling group, and they tend to oppose certain policies in certain areas, but not challenging the political regime as such. While non-systemic opposition emerged and operated beyond the control of the ruling group and aimed to major changes of the political regime. So, in mid-2000s, the opposition was what I called in one of my publications as a dying species. It was driven into very narrow ghettos, divided between various ideational stances, and of course the government effectively used divide-and-rule approach. And while systemic opposition parties lost their previous influence and their major goal was their own survival, non-systemic opposition were very noisy but rather well irrelevant groups, and typical gathering of non-systemic opposition, so-called Strategy 31, the monthly manifestation in Moscow, brought several dozen activists and probably the similar number of journalists who observed how police oppress these groups, but nobody else interested in what opposition doing. And of course there was a widespread phenomenon of social movements ranging from environment protection to so-called deceived investors, but they were very active in opposing certain policies of both federal and regional governments, but avoided and deliberately avoided, I would say, contacts with the opposition, and they understood well that politicization is the worst thing they could do in order to get their to reach their goals. And after 2007-2008, there were no serious, visible, meaningful post-election protests, which was actually a sharp contrast with what we observed more recently. So what changed after that? I would outline three major changes which played a decisive role in revival of the opposition. One is the process of generation changes. Actually, leaders of the opposition in the 2000s were people who belonged to the generation of 70s. Those who became adult during the period of Brezhnevism, those who capitalized their potential during the years of perestroika and reforms of the 1990s, but who reached their 50 years old age and who were oriented more or less retrospectively. They were driven by ideas of revenge, of what went wrong in the periods of 1990s and 2000s. And this was a sharp division with the younger generation. The younger generation grew up after the Soviet collapse. Probably the brightest representative of the younger generation of the opposition, Alexei Navalny, he born in 1976. So when the Soviet Union disappeared, he was 15 years old, and the whole framework of reference to Soviet system for him was more or less a distant past. And it was the same for other people from this generation. And of course, for a generation of newcomers, career aspirations faced with the dominance of their predecessors and the typical conflict of fathers versus sons in the Russian culture reemerged once again. There was no way for replacement of older generation of leaders in the government by the younger generation. One can't imagine that, well, one day Putin will step down and will appoint someone like Ksenia Sobchak as his successor. But in the opposition, it was quite possible. And actually, it was a major chance for revival. In 2013, one of the opposition parties, Parnas, led by a number of co-chairs, including two 54 years old co-chairs, Boris Nemtsov, former deputy prime minister of the Russian government, and Mikhail Kasyanov, former prime minister, they nominated Alexei Navalny, who was 37 years old, as a candidate for mayoral race in Moscow. It was very much symbolic moment of the generation changes. The second factor came not from the opposition as such, but rather from the government. I mean some attempts of liberalization under Dmitry Medvedev, which gave birth for some sort of legalization of the moderate part of the opposition. Medvedev actually attempted to widen the scope and size of public participation in decision making, whether or not it was manipulation or sincere approach, it's probably not much important. What was important is that many ideas advocated by the opposition, like more transparency, more openness, more emphasis on human rights, rule of law, and the like, were put onto official agenda. And the government, well, not completely ignored the opposition, but rather attempted to engage some of its representatives in whatever consultations and communications. And no wonder that when Medvedev and Putin announced that there will be a kind of substitution in 2011, that Putin will be back to presidency and Medvedev will take the job of prime minister, of course, it caused major disillusionment and discontent among not only among opposition as such, but among various social movements which flourished during this period, not necessarily political movements, they were oriented toward a very diverse set of issues ranging from some communities aimed to protect rights of car drivers to whistleblowers who raise the issue of plagiarism in dissertations of officials. So it was very wide array of issues and very diverse set of actors. And finally, the change in public mood, because after 2008 crisis, there was a rising demand for good governance. People became more and more concerned about corruption, about poor quality of public services, and raised their voice more actively and vocally. So all these three factors contributed to the rise of the opposition, and the turning point was 2011 parliamentary election, because the opposition organized a very effective negative campaign, and the very slogan "Vote for anyone but United Russia" ideally fits the perspective of negative consensus against the status quo. It doesn't matter whom you prefer, whom you vote. What is important is that you are against United Russia. Of course, the major beneficiary of this strategy was so-called systemic opposition. If you can't vote for United Russia, then you have to vote for somebody else. And somebody else very often means parties of so-called systemic opposition, like Communist Party of the Russian Federation, or Just Russia Party to some extent, some other actors, but certainly the post-election protest contributed to proliferation of whatever organized groups of the opposition, and even initially non-politicized groups and actors engaged in this process in the wake of parliamentary elections. And after that, of course, people observed meetings with dozens of thousands of participants in Moscow and thousands of participants in other areas. Of course, it was unrealistic to expect that these protests will reach their goals. And after a number of rallies and manifestations, the protests decreased upon 2012 presidential elections. So this process met the limits because first and foremost the electoral arena was occupied by the ruling group and systemic opposition parties. There was no way to propose alternative candidates for presidential elections. All these opportunities were missed. Also, the scale of mobilization was not enough for pushing the ruling group to somewhat major concessions, although certain concessions were made, but in a very different direction. And of course, systemic opposition parties still preferred the status quo, and they considered that if one day regime will be overthrown, certainly they will become victims of this disequilibration, while the preservation of the status quo brought them major benefits, namely votes and seats in the parliamentary elections. So, non-systemic opposition faced with severe constraints, to some extent they were inherited from the previous period, such as limited pool of available resources, quite low organizational capability. In fact, all political organizations were weak and they were unable to resolve what is known in social science as collective action problem, and the use of internet, social media also met with certain constraints because it's impossible to rely on these instruments alone if we have in mind not one-off event but rather day-by-day political struggle. Of course, the lack of political strategy, given the time constraints, opposition activists had no ideas how to prepare for next steps, and actually the failure of United Russia in 2011 elections and the scope of mass protests were rather underestimated by the opposition leaders, so they became a sort of victims of their own success. And also the opposition remained in relative isolation. There were not many important actors in the business circles, in the media, among other segments of elites who openly endorsed the opposition. Or those who endorsed were actually already on their side and not changed much their preferences. And of course, there was no major linkages with systemic opposition because they pursued rather different goals and certainly were not interested in overthrowing the status quo. So, in 2012 presidential elections, Putin won relatively easily and opposition had no chances to claim that he won only because of electoral fraud, even though electoral fraud took place in at least in certain areas. It was very serious, but it was not only electoral fraud because as the reason of Putin's victory. Probably Putin's victory could be less decisive without electoral fraud, but still it was a major challenge for the opposition. So what kind of lessons has been learned? First and foremost, Putin immediately upon his re-election announced that there will be a kind of tightening of the screws, and this was a major blow for the opposition. The Kremlin initiated the politics of fear in various ways. Many laws were amended and some charges for violations of rules of meetings and public gatherings were toughened. Also, criminal charges for defamation in the media were reinstalled. They were actually removed under Medvedev. Also, several attacks were organized toward NGOs, which were blamed as being foreign agents, and it was a campaign of public discrediting, and several NGOs forced to close down. Others announced that they will no longer receive aid from foreign donors, which was also problematic for their survival. And of course, after one of the meetings of the opposition, some dozens of participants were arrested and accused in violent clashes with the police. And they were not major figures of the opposition, but rather randomly chosen victims. And they should demonstrate the rest of the participants that they could be next victims. So all of that was politics of fear initiated from the Kremlin. But actually, the problem was not only with the Kremlin, but rather with the mass participation. The amount of participants sharply declined. According to estimates of the opposition, in December 2011, the number of those who participated in protest actions in Moscow was about 200,000. The same source, the opposition, demonstrated that in June and July 2013, the number of participants decreased up to 5,000. So, the period of mobilization was over. What to do? The opposition went to a different way, attempting to organize itself, and what has been proposed is a new entity called Coordinating Council of the Opposition. The idea was to establish a kind of collective leadership, and what has been proposed widely perceived as an alternative to allegedly rigged elections of 2011-2012, that everybody, every Russian citizen could register him or herself via web, then nominate whatever candidate, even self-nomination was welcomed, and then there was a procedure of voting through the set of organized polling stations, and actually more than 80,000 Russian citizens participated in these elections. The composition of Coordinating Council was designed in such a way that certain share of seats was designated for various ideological groups, for liberals, for lefts, and for lefty and for nationalists. And also, two-thirds of the opposition coordination council were elected through an open contest. So the very idea was probably bright. The problem was what the coordinating council will do. And actually, it was not so bright idea to organize elections for the sake of free elections. There were free elections, but there was not a powerful body. The Coordinating Council should coordinate mass manifestations and protests, but by the time when this council was elected, the mobilization wave came down. Also, this was an idea that possibly it will be a kind of collective body for bargaining with authorities, but certainly authorities were not inclined to bargain with the opposition. So, in October 2012, it met first ever time, but then it became clear, and actually meetings of this council translated via web, that the agenda is empty. The Coordinating Council spent endless hours in discussing procedural matters, organizational matters, but over time some elected members left Coordinating Council, and finally it was realized that the Coordinating Council was elected just for a year, and in October 2013, when this term has been expired, de facto, the Coordinating Council ceases to exist. The alternative, however, opened after the wave of protests, because the Kremlin revised the rules of registration of political parties, and also opened possibilities for gubernatorial elections. So, the opposition faced with the challenge what to do in electoral politics. easy to run, to nominate candidates and endorse them, or to boycott, or vote for anyone but United Russia or but the government and the like. Actually, the opposition intended to participate in elections. Several political parties were established or re-established, and several activists of the opposition participated in elections, but not much successful. One of the most well-known cases was Evgenia Chirikova. She was the leader of local environment movement in the city of Khimki, nearby Moscow, and she gained a nationwide reputation as an activist who turned into an opposition figure. She had a strong basis of local support in her city because she organized a campaign for protection of Khimki Forest, a green area nearby center of the city, against building of new highway, and even thought this protest has lost. She was a strong and visible enough person. Still, Chirikova was not much successful in mayoral elections, and not only because these elections were unfair. In 2009, when she ran for the post of city mayor first ever time, she got 15% of votes. In 2013, when Chirikova already was a member of coordinating council of the opposition, she was not just a local figure, but the figure of nationwide recognition, she got just slightly above this share of votes, almost 18%. So it was not a big difference. The same was with the opposition parties. Some of them were denied registration, some of them were unable to participate in regional elections, but even in some sort of minor successes, it doesn't bring a lot of rewards for the opposition. The party RPR Parnas, which I already mentioned, ran in regional legislative elections in Yaroslavl. As a result, it got 6% of votes and one seat in the legislature, and the co-chair of this party, Boris Nemtsov, became a member of Legislative Assembly in Yaroslavl. So these minor advances of the opposition were not a major trouble for the government. Moreover, it was a problem or threat of being a niche opposition, which can attract a certain number of votes, but cannot beat the government. However, there was a major exception, and this was exception in mayoral elections in the city of Moscow in September 2013. Navalny was nominated as a candidate for these elections, and he was able to organize a very dynamic and energetic campaign. He gained support from various corners of society, mainly from young voters, and he also effectively used crowdfunding techniques, organized door-to-door campaigns. So finally he got 27.3%, and the incumbent mayor Sergei Sobyanin received just slightly above 50% of votes. So in fact more than 600,000 Moscovites voted for Navalny, and of course it was quite a visible success of the opposition. Still, the question of how to build effective organization, how to run on elections, is not resolved as of yet. What about systemic opposition? Actually, it just pretend to support the status quo, And also attempted to avoid risks of being punished by the ruling group. No wonder that these parties expelled dissidents from their ranks, those who were inclined to maintain contact with non-systemic oppositions. Also, systemic opposition parties very actively and vocally endorsed most anti-democratic legal initiatives and were probably even more active than United Russia as such. Or some of its representatives prefer silence or some sort of maneuvering, but not inclined to bridge with the non-systemic opposition. And of course, key challenges lies ahead. Not only this politics of fear, but also the problem of low support of the non-systemic opposition. Even those voters who are very critical towards the current government, not much support the opposition either. It's not a kind of zero-sum game, and if the alternative to the status quo is not much popular, then status quo will survive nearly by default, or what Richard Rose and others called as resigned acceptance model. And of course, the understanding that regime will be not overthrown overnight, and it would require very long day-by-day work and very complicated and continuous efforts actually made a demobilizing effect for a number of likes of the opposition. So let's turn to a more broader perspective, and I will focus on the issues outlined by Alfred Stepan, the scholar of comparative politics, irrespectively to Russia. He actually designed the list of tasks for democratic opposition under authoritarianism based upon experience of Latin America and Eastern Europe and some countries like South Korea. His list is visible here, resisting cooptation into the regime, guarding zones of autonomy vis-a-vis the regime, disrupting regime's legitimacy, rising the costs of preservation of the status quo, and creating a credible democratic alternative. All these tasks are relevant for present-day Russia. However, I would say that while the tasks of A and B, resisting cooptation and guarding zones of autonomy are relatively easy to do, the most problematic is the last point, the creating a credible democratic alternative, as well as disrupting of regime's legitimacy. That's the major and sharp difference between authoritarian regimes in communist Eastern Europe and in Latin America with present-day Russia. Those authoritarian regimes were illegitimate from the beginning. They were either imposed by the Soviets or came to power because of military coups. Nothing like that observed in Russia. Actually, this is a regime elected by the people. Well, they were fraudulent elections, but still there is an electoral mechanism of legitimation. Also, there is quite a visible and significant part of Russians who still support this status quo regime. And the very perspective of organized resistance in the of civil society versus the state, what was the motto of Eastern European dissidents, is not much relevant for present-day Russia. So what opposition could do to maintain negative consensus against the regime? This is important that no perceptions and the status quo is a lesser evil among the opposition. also building bridges and seeking allies both among elites and society at large. Actually, if you have a look on some data of elite surveys, we will find out that there is a relatively big share of elites who aligned with the opposition in their hearts and minds, but not much in their deeds. This is even more true for business. Actually, Navalny was able to attract certain support from some businesses, but these were just isolated cases. Concerting, not an organizational unity, but rather mutual support and informal collaboration among various segments of the opposition. Certainly, there is a need for advancement of new ideas and new credible public figures. And of course, the approach worse is better is certainly relevant. While some people hope that possible economic stagnation or recession will be a major good news for the opposition, it's just ridiculous and irrelevant understanding what is good and what is bad for the opposition and for the country as a whole. Let me stop at this moment. Thank you. That's it. Thank you.